Thanks for tuning into Shaw Arts and Entertainment. I'm Curtis Anderson, arguably the biggest day so far in Shaw Arts and Entertainment. If you know anything about the sport of pro wrestling, you will know the guy sitting beside me. Ladies and gentlemen, the best there is, the best there was, the best there ever will be, Bret the Hitman Hart. Bret, thank you so much for talking to us today, taking time out of your busy day. Currently in Saskatoon with a production called Aladdin. I guess tell me a little about your new venue here.
Well, you know, it's a whole new experience for me, but in a lot of ways, there's a lot of similarities to what I always did. I'm just a character in a show, and the best part about this show is I don't wake up every day feeling like somebody rolled me off a cliff, you know?
Obviously, people know you as a famous wrestler, but a lot of acting background, Lonesome Dove in the 90s, as well as a quick spot on The Simpsons, so kind of keeping doing what you love, right?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how much of a difference sometimes. Wrestling is basically a form of acting anyway, mm-hmm. In the sense that we act with our bodies. And I think the memory process for remembering a complicated wrestling match is comparable to someone doing acting and doing Hamlet on stage or something. You know, there's a lot of memory and a lot of thinking, and people not even aware of what the process is of a wrestler remembering when to move, when to duck, when to do all these things. And wrestling matches, especially some of the longer ones I've had, like hour matches and things like that, are really complicated, and there's a much more of a critical if you forget or you screw up somewhere, can result in serious injury kind of thing. So the acting for doing television or movies or what I'm doing here with the play is it's much simpler for me, and this is a very fun, simple play for me to, it's all kind of written around my wrestling character.
There is an element of wrestling in it.
Yeah, anyone that's even remotely a wrestling fan of mine will love the humor that's sort of all tied in very tastefully with wrestling. I mean, I'm very proud of my wrestling career, and I'm very proud of what it gave to me. And despite what anyone might think, I mean, I've always been very grateful for what wrestling gave me and the fans that supported me through years and years and years of doing it. I did it for 300 days a year, 23 years in a row, and I gave everything I could to that profession. And I'm happy to say that most people appreciate that today and stop me all the time to tell me how much of an impact I made on their lives as a Saturday morning TV hero, or and even years ago when I worked here in Saskatoon as, you know, with the Stampede Wrestling, which was a much grittier, tougher kind of life back then. But all in all, I have great memories from wrestling, and I'm proud of what I did in it, and I'm glad that people remember me for it. And but I also understand that there's not a lot of places left that I can sort of move into, like what else I can do. Having suffered a stroke, I pretty much feared that my acting days and anything athletic all these kind of things were over for me. And as I slowly struggled to recover from that, one hair at a time kind of thing, I saw this as an opportunity to prove something to myself, if anything, for one last time, that I could sort of be the old Bret Hart that I used to be. And I'm grateful that these guys invited me to be on the show. I'm grateful that they wrote such a fun script around my old wrestling character and resurrected me for one last, and funny enough, the one last tour of all the old towns and cities that I used to earn a living as.
I was going to say, this is another chance to come through Canada, which you haven't had for a while. Talk a little bit about Saskatoon. Big fan of Saskatoon. I overheard your very first wrestling match here in Saskatoon, and of course, winning the world title from Ric Flair back when you were with the WWE back in 1992 at Sask Place, and now Credit Union Center.
Yeah, it seems like a long time ago. I can remember driving here, and I was actually the referee back in the beginning, and they got stuck and they needed me. I was learning how to wrestle. Mm-hmm. I was not a wrestler, not officially by any means. And I got asked to sub in because I think they were just short. There was nobody left, and I ended up replacing somebody and working in a tag match. And you know, to think back those days, I probably had skinny white arms, and you know, I was white as a ghost and not very big and powerful looking. Nothing like the old Hitman character became 10 years later, but you know, you start out and you start from a humble kind of beginning. And one thing I think that people relate to with me is that I started at the very bottom and I worked slowly all the way to the very top. And you think of so many wrestlers, you know, I would watch wrestlers come into WWF back in the late 80s, early 90s, and they would hand them this big spot, you know, whether it was Macho Man or Warrior, they just give these guys these the big push to the top. And I was working so hard and fighting for every inch I could get and just hanging on all the time, and I slowly climbed all the way up to the top. And I think that's the reason that my my fan audience or the fan base that I've had through all the years has never diminished too much, or if anything it's got bigger, is because they understand that I really worked hard for what I the credit I got as a great wrestler. And I think I was a great wrestler. I don't, wrestling is kind of, it's not a sport like hockey where you can go, well, Wayne Gretzky was the greatest hockey player because he's got the points, he's got the stats, you can look at what he did and you watch him score and you know how great he was. Wrestling is sort of, they tell you who's great, and they, the history that they write around wrestling is often fabricated, or it's basically what they want to sell you on. But I think in my case, people understand when they watched me wrestle, and they still watch me now, they go that I was a unique wrestler that had a style and a commitment to reality-based wrestling that is non-existent in today's wrestling.
I saw an interview with you about a decade ago, and you claimed that, and SummerSlam 92, British Bulldog, your best match ever. Does that still hold true?
Pretty much. I you know, there's different styles. Like, the Bulldog match was probably my favorite just because it was 82,000 fans at Wembley Stadium, and the fans were so beautiful. Like, if you watch that match back, you look on the faces of the kids, they're just so excited. And it's basically what they call a baby face match, which is considered kind of boring and not interesting. Everyone wants a good guy, bad guy kind of rivalry. But this was a baby face match, and it kind of gave wrestling it was a really sort of beautiful moment of, I remember my father used to say to me, he said, it's one thing to have a great match, but it's another thing to have a great match in front of 82,000. And it was such a beautiful night. The sky was so purple, and they feared rain all day long, and it didn't rain, and it was just, the memory of it was a beautiful thing. But the match I had with Steve Austin in Chicago, which was probably not a beautiful thing, but that was probably a great match. It's on a different level, you know, just the sort of the intensity of a real brawl like that can, you know, that's what wrestling can give you.
Let's talk a little bit about the good guy, bad guy formula. That was 1997, probably my favorite year of wrestling, I'd have to be honest. Everything kind of switched. You were the good guy up till then, and then they did something with your character that I don't think has ever been done before. They made you a bad guy everywhere, or just in the States, actually. You're still a good guy, Canada, everywhere else, but in the States, you were hated.
Yeah, it was an interesting concept, because in a lot of ways, at that time, the wrestling fans were the bad guys.
Yeah,
they're the ones that were they were all about the anti-hero. And
was that a rewarding role for you? It kind of seemed like you might have been a little frustrated around that time, and it was a good. I thought some of your best interviews were done around that time.
It was, because it was all reality based, which is what I worked best from. If you could give me a kind of a real scenario, I could make it real. But if you gave me a really hokey scenario, it was hard for me to make it seem real or make myself, they gave me some pretty hokey storylines over the years. But that was one where I, you know, when you were trying really hard to be a hero, and you were a hero everywhere else, but, like, I was a hero in, like, wrestling in London and Germany, even Bahrain. I remember I wrestled in Bahrain around that time, and I get greeted at the airport by, like, thousands of Canadian flags at the airport, and it was just, you know, it's a really nice memory. And then you get off the plane, you land in Philadelphia or something like that, or Boston.
Disrespected.
And they're throwing stuff at you, and you're really just going out there, you're the same guy, you're doing the same stuff.
Yep.
And, you know, they just, wrestling fans in the States had got tired of the same old thing, and they actually went to the shows back then, and the WCW had a lot to do with it, maybe ECW, but they just kind of came to disrupt the audience, and they would go against the grain all the time and make it uncomfortable for kids and the older fans that were that old kind of old school wrestling fan to even speak up. They were kind of more intimidated, and you didn't get the same reactions anymore. And guys like Steve Austin would go out there and be beating you with a chair, and the people would be cheering.
Yeah.
And it kind of messed up all the psychology of what wrestling is really about. And the only way to combat that was to do what I did, which was to go right back at them and give them, you know, give the bad guys exactly what they're giving you.
Of course, the relationship with the WWF, WWE soured. You were off to WCW, but recently, about a year ago, came back together, put together Bret the Hitman Hart DVD. Was that really rewarding for you?
Yeah, you know, one of my big gripes with WWF and was probably a bit of, was carried a lot of my bitterness about things that happened with him, is that I really resented the fact that they were going to minimize my what I contributed. Yeah. And they did too. Like, there was a best of WrestleMania DVD they put out a few years ago, and if you watch that back, most of the they put on my worst match that I ever had in a pay-per-view on that book, on that DVD as one of my great matches, which was not one of my great matches, it was one of the worst ones I ever had. And they always put little clips of me usually getting kicked in the face, or Steve Austin putting me in a sharpshooter, or Shawn Michaels dropkick. And whenever they showed me doing something, it was always something not so special, you know. Like, and those kind of things really bothered me, because I thought, you know, I really did some great stuff, but they're minimizing everything I ever did. And when they approached me about this, originally they were going to do a DVD that was going to be called Screwed, which was going to be sort of like the Ultimate Warriors DVD, where they buried me all the way through it. And I actually saw what they were going to put out. I'm so glad that they didn't do it, and that I did manage to do this and do something that my fans would be proud of. But they're kind of a mean, nasty company, and that's never going to change. You know, that's how they do business, and they can ruin you, and they're very vindictive, and they have a mean spirit. And that's just how they are, and that's how the wrestling business is. But I did manage to get this, and I hope that they'll still consider doing a volume two of some of the matches that we couldn't get on here.
Last year, inducted to the WWE Hall of Fame, completely by your terms, I understand. Your message was, Bret Hart is okay. That was pretty much the short message. Is that still true?
Yeah, I'm okay. I think, you know, if anything, I got lots left to do in this. Mm-hmm. You know, as a whole, I figure I've got a... You know, it's the old saying, if you can get over the first half of your life, you know, the second half becomes even more important.
The wrestling world seems to really pay tribute to the, you know, the stars of the 80s and stuff. Ever kind of get the urge maybe to come back as a commissioner or something? Because there seems to be more and more roles like that popping up. Nothing?
No, I'm really proud of being, I think I was the best wrestler, I think. I mean, I know there's a lot of great wrestlers out there, and a lot of people may debate that or argue that, but you know, I wrestled 23 years. I never injured one wrestler, and I was all about the art and the skill of being a great wrestler. And I want to be remembered as a great wrestler. I don't want to be remembered as a commissioner or a referee or an old washed-up wrestler that hung on too long. And I see some wrestlers like Hulk Hogan or Ric Flair, or even Roddy Piper, still hanging on. And I don't begrudge them at all. I mean, that's their life, and that's what they want to do, and as long as that's what they do, that's fine. But that's not how I want to be remembered. I want to be remembered as that champion that I always was.
Lots of wrestlers make the bestseller list writing books now. Any chance of that in the future? Everyone's still interested in
my
Bret Hart story?
My book is coming out in the fall next year.
Fantastic.
It should, anyways. That's the plan. Anyway.
And it's going to cover?
It should cover everything. Yeah. Should fill in a lot of blanks for people.
All right, we'll keep searching for that. I guess lastly, Bret, how does Bret Hart want to be remembered?
I just want to be remembered as a great Canadian. As a Canadian that gave his best.
All right, part of the Aladdin production in Saskatoon over the weekend. Where are you off to next?
Thank God I get back to Calgary. But it'll be like 22 below zero, I think, when I get there. So I don't know how much fun you can have in Calgary in that kind of weather, but I'll find a way.
Bret, thank you so much for joining us today. The best there is, the best there was, the best there ever will be. 5-time World Wrestling Federation champion, King of the Ring, Royal Rumble winner, tag team, you've done it all.
2-time WCW champion, but not that that counts for a whole lot. But.
He's done it all in the wrestling business. Thank you so much for your time today, Bret. Good luck in Aladdin and your future endeavors.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Can I grab one more quick interview from, or quick signature from you?
Sure.
Oh.
Well, I'm glad it's a WWF belt anyway. If you pull out the WCW.
And I don't know where you're at, where the relationship is here, but I got the honky tonk man to sign it last time. No.
Is this the Intercontinental?
It's
the...
Yeah, Intercontinental.
That was my favorite.
They don't even have this title anymore, do they?
Nope. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay.
This is nice to...
Nice. You going to come see the show?
Well...